Hey smokers, Dragawan here. Today we're going to be setting up a computer specifically for recording stuff inside the freezer. You're probably asking, why would you want to do that? Well, it turns out that when stuff is freezing, if you see it in time lapse, it looks frickin' cool. No pun intended, of course. It's going to be pretty easy to set up. It's not going to take too much time. And it's not going to take up too much space or really be invasive in using the freezer itself. So let's go ahead and get started. Actually, everything we have in front of us is what we need. See, we have the EyeSight right here. As you can see, it's working. There's a really old, frickin' old copy of iStop Motion that I bought back in 2007. My product key still works, and their download site actually is still there. So that's convenient. And so you can set it up so that it actually will record every so many seconds. It'll take a frame every so many seconds. So let me, I have it currently set, I'll set it to 1 second so you can sort of see what it does. So as you can see, it does this sort of onion skinning thing, and it makes a popping noise. So this is if you want to do stop motion type stuff, and it's really useful for that. But really, all we're going to be doing is using it for. Look, you can even make the onion skinning more crazy. Oh God, it's freaking out, dude. So you get the idea. It's a time lapse thing. You can also do time lapse with. Other pieces of software. I think you can even do it with iMovie. I don't have a copy of iMovie HD on here, but you can do something similar with that. We're not going to be using that right now. It might not actually let us lock into EyeSight mode using an EyeSight camera. The reason I'm using an EyeSight camera is because, well, it plays well with this software. It's really super easy to set up and plug in. Will just work seamlessly, flawlessly with Mac OS X. And look at that! Look at that frame right there. flawlessly with Mac OS X, and it'll just get up and go. USB cameras, especially on these older Mac Minis, pretty much don't work, I think, unless you get updated Mac OS. So we'll go ahead and get started here. This is all pretty much ready to go. What we're going to do is we're going to hook this up to a network. And remote into it to control it. This is going to be a headless setup. I think it is already set to auto login. So all we have to do is move this to the freezer. Okay, so my tripod won't actually go up high enough to show the top of the fridge. I know I could find some ways around that, but let's just start setting this up here. So that's, okay, it's not going to be quite this close to the edge, but just so you can see it. There's the Mac Mini. And in the back of it, we have the EyeSight. As you can see, it has a very, very convenient magnetic hold there. It can go pretty much wherever you need it to go. So that's going to help out. We have all the power supply goodies. So we'll go ahead and plug that in there. And, you know, being a Mac Mini, it's not going to take up a lot of space. Not going to have any real problem being up there. Not like having a tower or something else. So you may have seen the EyeSight kind of power cycle there. The Mac Mini isn't on, but it's apparently getting some power through that. So since it's so far away from everything, you know, of course we have this. I could just connect it to my internal network, but I just wanted to have this just so you can have it set up totally separate from your network. You can have it on your network if you want. This is just how I'm setting it up right now. I'm going to plug it into this. And then this will be, we'll connect whatever we want to this so that we can access and share the screen of this computer here. So just so we can kind of have a little self-contained network just for this. And so you can see all the processes in this. It's possible to do have this Mac Mini share a network, but if you do that, the only option it gives you on 10.6 is WEP. And I don't really want to use WEP, because that's even worse than crack. So now we're all set up there. Let's go ahead and power that on. And then shove this back. And turn it so that all the cables go to the side and don't fall in front of the fridge. So that's just going to be out of the way there. So what about the camera? What are we going to do with that? Actually, the camera's getting warm. So if we take a look in the fridge here, I have a metal surface that now has frost on it. But the reason I have that metal surface is, and hopefully this camera lens doesn't get frost on it, is to have a solid surface for that. So when we finally tuck everything inside, we can close it and it'll be fine. So what are we going to freeze? What are we going to film? So right here I have a thing of tap water. Over here I have a thing of distilled water. And they pretty much look the same when they're in their liquid form. But I was doing some experiments a couple years ago, and what I found out was when you freeze tap water, it looks like shit. But when you freeze distilled water, it looks amazing. So we're going to start off with our control thing here and freeze the tap water first. So with the Mac Mini on right now, let's go ahead and open this. We will have to frame up our shot. This is tap water indicated by the T. And we'll go ahead and just close that for now. Now, one thing to worry about. Am I going to freeze my camera and have it not work? Maybe. There are some mechanical elements inside. I don't know if that's going to get too much condensation and fuck up. Last time I did this with a Logitech webcam, it didn't have any issue. It survived just fine. So what about lighting? What are we going to do about that? Okay, so this is my current bedside lamp. Previously, when I tried this last time, I had used an incandescent bulb, and that sort of heated things up in the freezer. This is a very old LED bulb, so it's not going to make a lot of heat in there. I actually used this very lamp and bulb for my last experiment for freezing stuff. So let's go ahead and put that in there. I don't want to open the freezer too much, or it's going to defrost all my food. Don't exactly have a whole lot of room here. Shit. And then we'll run the cable up and over and out, and then we'll turn it off. Or on. Off. Okay, so now we should have light inside. Whoa, we got a lot of light inside. All right. Okay, so that should light up the scene as well as can be expected. So let's go ahead and close it for now. Okay, so we're back here again. So the next thing we need to do is, since that Mac Mini is on, we got to get another Mac Mini and hook it up. That should be enough. All right. Okay, so we got it up, and I see the Mac Mini that's on top of the fridge. Let's go ahead and do a share screen on it. And there's the desktop. So let's go ahead and launch up iStop Motion. Now everything's going to be kind of lagged, but we're only doing this. Okay, so we want to put this on. Yeah, this is pretty compression artifacty here. Not a big deal. Okay, let's see if we can actually get it in focus here. Can we adapt? So as you can see, the camera is actually focusing autofocus. I didn't know EyeSight had an autofocus at all. I kind of wish it didn't. I don't think there's any way to stop it from autofocusing unless I move it further away from the subject or have something in the foreground it can focus on. So that's the Walker enemy from Deus Ex, featured there in pink. And it seems to have stopped the autofocusing. Maybe I should find something a little smaller. Okay, that's a little bit better. So basically, what's going to have to happen now is we'll start the time lapse. I'm going to set it at 10 seconds because water freezes pretty slow. And this is really just going to be a test. This is not the main thing I wanted to capture as part of this project. I just want to start this to see if that makes sense. Can iStop Motion handle long, hour-long time lapse? I have no idea. So we're going to find out. So we're going to do it every 10 seconds. Right now there's a bit of condensation on the glass that will be going away, I think. So, not a big deal. Let's go ahead and start. And I will, from the other room, hear... You probably won't be able to hear it, but I'm going to hear little pinging sounds from that Mac Mini over there. Yeah, there it goes. They took the first frame. Now, again, this is an iSight. iSight is extremely old. And it's only 640 by 480. But it's the only camera I'm willing... this old junker iSight. It's the only camera I'm willing to put in a freezing environment. Because if this thing just dies in the middle of this, I'm not going to care that much. And then I'll just switch back over to my USB camera. So... we'll just see how well this goes. The iSight is probably going to be permanently damaged in this process. It does have a microphone in it. It does have autofocus. Every time it focuses, it makes a little eh sound. So it's kind of cute, but that might break. Hopefully it does, so that I don't have to worry about autofocus. And again, the floppy disk there is just to keep the focus solid, because the camera probably thinks this is some sort of flat surface it can't really focus on too well. So we want to make sure that it is focused there, so that if this is clear, we know that this is going to be clear. Again, so this is a tap water. I'm going to let this run and turn down the volume, because that's going to get annoying as hell. So we haven't even recorded 1 second of footage yet. You can probably not see what's going on. So there is the sort of timeline there. It's going to be pretty dang slow because we are remoting in. You can see the individual frames there. And there, I just took another one. So it's going to keep doing that, and then hopefully we'll be able to play it back and actually see it freezing. Now this is... an experiment that, if you have a couple Mac Minis and an iSight, or maybe just a USB camera, assuming I can't remember when they made it so that you could just use USB cameras as a camera on Mac OS X. But assuming you have all that, you have this stuff just sitting around, you can really easily set up a freezer recording stuff. You can record some pretty cool looking stuff, and I did in the past, but the quality on it was god awful. So maybe this will be a little bit better. It is only 640 by 480, so. Let's see what it looks like. I'm going to let this sit here for a while. It's going to be a couple hours before it actually will be frozen. So 10 seconds may be too short of an interval, but this is really going to be our test run before we do the main one. So let's just go ahead and wait a frickin' long time.
Well, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. I started this I don't know how many hours ago. And man, it's not done yet. Got quite a ways to go. I think this freezer's slower than the last one I used. So, I just woke up from just a horrendous fucking nightmare. And wouldn't you know it, the thing is, like, auto-focusing now, so that's great. So, now we'll have to wait and see what it looks like when it gets done. Okay, so it's now about 7:30 a.m. The autofocus has been going in and out since, you know, the middle of the night. So I'm going to try and move that floppy disk to the foreground so at least we can capture the rest of it without it looking like garbage. So let me go move it right now. Okay, so I got the autofocus to stop, but I had to obscure the actual subject here. So that's kind of inconvenient. We can't really see too much detail inside of the container. I guess that's because we have low resolution going on. But I'm going to let it keep running and let it finish freezing. It is not done yet. And we'll get right back to this.
Shit. Okay, so what happened was I was trying to change the video settings for the camera. It looked like there was a setting in there somewhere to change the autofocus when the program crashed. I just shit myself because I lost everything. But I used disk inventory to index the hard disk, and this is the footage we recorded so far, this gigantic fucking block. I can't even copy this out of here because if you try to fit this in any way, it won't even... Wait, hold on. I don't know. Let me see. Show free space. Okay, so never mind. We're fine. But this 5 gigabytes of footage we've recorded so far, it's this temporary file in documents. It's a hidden file. I'm going to see if I can't copy it out. But holy crap, we may have lost everything. I'm not sure. Let me see if I can get this thing open. Probably can't even reveal it in Finder because it's hidden. Yeah, okay. I do not want to reopen iStop Motion until that is copied out of there. So this should reveal hidden files. Okay, here we go. There's a movie file right there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a copy of it. We're kind of running out of time. Okay, so I really think that 10 seconds was too big of an interval. This may not, we may not even be able to play this back. 5 gigabytes, oh my god. this is kind of nuts here. This is kind of stupid. Oh man. I was going to think, wow, what a cool video, no pun intended, I could make. Really simple, easy, nothing's going to go wrong, but guess what? Shit keeps going wrong! So we're going to let this copy. We're not going to miss much. I'm going to relaunch iStop Motion. I'm going to see if there's actually an option for document recovery. It might just delete this temporary file by the time it starts up. So, okay, file's copied. Let's see if I can actually launch the our copy here. See if it'll play back. Fuck. Well, I mean, all the frames are there. Maybe we can reconstruct it later. Let's see if it'll actually launch and recover the document. And it deleted it. Or did it move it? Oh, wait, what is this? Did it clean it up? Did it make it unhidden? What's going on here? I think it may have cleaned it up. Because now it's not hidden anymore. It's just there. So I guess that's how it manages fucking document recovery. Let's see if this one will launch now. Okay, well now it wants to open it with QuickTime Player 7? I don't want to open it with QuickTime Player 7. I just want to open it with this. Okay, fine. All right. So let's... That doesn't open anyway, so let's newly that. Open recent. Let's just try and open this with iStop Motion. Defaults to that, so let's open it. Oh my god. Are you serious? You can't even open the own shit you made? I guess that's because it crashed, I guess. Fuck. Well, we're fucked. So this is why we did a test run, just to sort of feel out exactly what this software does and how it's just inherently broken. So well, if it crashes, that is, it has no handling for crashes whatsoever. Don't go into the settings menu. Don't go into the settings menu, whatever it takes. Okay, so let's see what happens when we go back into the video settings here. So this is what crashed it last time. Something's wrong with the UI up here. It's probably crashing right now. White balance. And we got temperature. So go to source, eyesight, image. This is what crashed it. Okay, so we got shutter, we got exposure, mechanical, focus. All right. So we can actually focus it from here. This is very rare that any kind of software lets you change this. So let's take a look at the viewport here. Can we change the focus in real time? Let's change it to 1 and see what it looks like. Well, that just fucking breaks it. Oh! Okay. So, yeah, we can. We can control the focus. So I believe it was the proper focus, focal length, or whatever the fuck these numbers are, was 67. Let's see what happens if we put it at 100, which would be far out into the distance, I assume. I guess was that to do it real time? No. Okay. Well, let's put it on 100. It's still out of focus. I guess focus too far out? I guess 67 was just magic. I mean, at least you can freaking focus it. Oh my god. Okay. It's in focus. Now I can get rid of the floppy disk. Okay, this is a very cold floppy disk. So now, before we get started again, there's some brightness settings, saturation settings, hue settings, shutter. You can actually change the shutter. Wow, holy piss. This is actually pretty cool. The frickin' eyesight has more settings than... The eyesight has more settings than my last camera did. The current camera I'm recording this on now, of course, is far superior. But, oh my god, this is crazy. I mean, it's a pain in the ass to change all these settings and stuff, but... So what happens if I go like this? See, I don't know what these numbers mean. They don't make any sense for any kind of shutter information. It's supposed to... There's different terminology for this that it's just absolutely not using at all. Now, I just made it dark. So I kind of just wish I did all of this before we started. I didn't know this was even an option. Fuck. I don't know. I don't even know what I'd want to put that at. I guess... Deactivate it for now. As for the color, we want the white balance... Deactivated the temperature. I guess we'll deactivate the temperature too. Oh, well, I can't have it both ways. All right. Somewhere there. These numbers just mean nothing. Okay. Whoa, God! It's piss. It's Girardi. We froze Okay. Okay. Well, that's not gonna work. I'll just let it do its own thing. Okay. So really the only thing we're changing here is everything's staying the same except for the focus, which we're keeping manual. Okay. So we'll start this going again. I'm going to keep it at 10 seconds. And now, since this has started, let's take a look at Finder. It's already created a new one. And we'll finish this up, see what it was doing, see if we can get everything else tweaked out, and then we'll be back. Okay, so basically everything went wrong. iStop Motion crashed again. I couldn't recover the previous file. It just didn't work at all. So we lost that first part. The glass cracked, which, you know, isn't really surprising. I'll pour out a little bit more of the water in the other one, so hopefully that doesn't happen. It took a lot longer than I thought for it to freeze, so if we have less water, it'll probably freeze faster. We're going to do the same 10-second interval time, but we're going to save it every hour. And then we can actually keep some footage actually survivable. This is all we have right now. It was taken when it was pretty much mid-freeze. This is playing back over remote desktop, so it's going to be pretty slow. The footage is actually pretty slow anyway. Actually, I don't think it's moving at all. I think that's just showing the first frame of the video. Yeah, I think that is what it's doing. Something definitely happened to this video. Like, let me... Yeah, here we go. Ooh, it's like trying to render the fade-out effect of the window border. Yeah, so that's what's happening. That was the glass breaking. And that's the completed freeze right there. That took, I don't know how many hours, 6 hours? I guess my freezer's not very cold. So the thing's broken. You know, it's been a very bad course of events. We had a crash, and then we had the glass crack. I would have taken it out of the freezer long ago if this had actually been working, and I didn't want to get more footage. So that sucks. So what we're going to do is exactly what we did before. We're just going to use iStopMotion. iMovie will not work. It will not recognize the camera. So we're just going to get iStopMotion back up here again. It's the only thing that recognizes the camera. We're going to set the 640 by 480. There we go. We want to set the focus to 67 and lock it there. Some broken ass shit, I swear to God. Focus is still set to manual. We're still going to do 10 second intervals. But we can save it whenever we want, even while it's recording. So let me switch out the container. Okay, this is probably as good as we're gonna get here. Around 10 seconds. I'm going to be watching this very closely. So this is the distilled water now. There's a lot less in there than there was in the other one, so it has room to expand upwards and hopefully not outwards. It's still probably going to crack the thing. I've cracked several of these things trying to do this. You kind of need glass for this. Probably not. Everybody's going to think I'm fucking retarded for doing this, but it wouldn't be the first time that's happened. So we can save this while it is going. It won't actually stop it. It's actually going to keep going. So we can save it every so often. I'm going to see if I can save it every 10 minutes if I can. Because if this thing crashes, whew, it's going to be a nightmare. All right, we'll see what happens at the end of this. Okay, so basically everything went wrong. iStopMotion crashed again.
Okay, just woke up again. It's another day's gone by. And this is our completed distilled water. The thing is about these recordings is they're low resolution, but they show detail in the motion of how these things are created. I have a pretty good camera now, so I'm going to take a pretty good picture, hopefully, of this jar here. This is the completed freeze. There was a lot of fracturing up at the top, which kind of, I guess you could say, kind of ruined it on this part. This is where the cool stuff is. You'll see it when I play it back. But I think this was actually a pretty good one. So I'm going to let this save. I have saved it quite a few times. This is the fifth one that I've saved. What I did was, because the problem is this is taking a long time. If this runs for as long as just a minute of time, just a minute, this is like a couple gigs, I think. Let's see. Okay, so when I first saved it, it was 2.5 megs. These are about 30 seconds of time, and they somehow get up to be 1.3 gigs. I don't really know how. Is it shooting them, like, bitmap? Is each frame a bitmap? What the fuck? This is ridiculous.
The funny part is when I transcode it using FFmpeg, they lower down to like a couple megabytes each, and it looks exactly the same. This is very long, just a minute worth of time has passed. Most of it is probably spent just looking at an unmoving, frozen block of ice.
So it saved successfully. I'm going to copy it off on the USB so that it doesn't get destroyed, and then let's go take a look at the thing in the freezer. Yeah, that 1 minute of footage is 3 gigabytes. So it's copying right now. No use in worrying about messing up the recording because everything's recorded. Either it's going to record or didn't record. There's no way to have it refreeze again without another, I don't know how many hours. Ooh, that was a good one. Sorry, I have autofocus on. It's just been frustrating with my camera lately, guys. It's weird. Yeah, I don't have a lens on this right now that can zoom in really far just to sort of see what it is in its environment. Yeah, so yeah, that's what it has looked like after all that. It's got now frost on the outside, so hopefully it doesn't, like, explode on me when I try to do this, but okay, we got it. Okay, I don't have a macro lens to really do this justice. Let's wipe some of this frost off of here. It's gonna be hard to keep it off, but this thing has started to crack a bit since I took it out, so it's really hard to capture this sometimes, but neat looking air bubble crystal formations in there. Again, it's hard as hell to keep we got some fracturing going on, probably because I left it in there too long. But, it looks pretty cool. Came out pretty nice. Yeah, you can see inside there, this is kind of like a tree. Everything converges in at that point. And here you can see it a lot better here. You can sort of see these kind of lines going in. Now, if you do this with tap water, again, this didn't come out great, but if you do this with tap water, you probably can see some of these lines, but it looks bad. because of the impurities in the water and all that. Yeah, so you can see when I rotate it, see the lines just going towards the center there. And I'm glad this jar didn't break, because I would like to reuse this. And then you can see that ball in the center, which was the last thing to freeze. Well, I'm going to try and take some pictures of this, and yeah. So yeah, here's a better shot of the individual ice crystals here, or whatever you want to call them. Of them all kind of converging into the center there as if it was some sort of, like, reverse. When you watch it, it's like some sort of reverse supernova explosion. It's like an implosion of these crystals into the center. I had never seen this before when I was trying to freeze water. Usually it just looks like that. And so you don't really think about it. It fractures a lot with all the impurities. But if you freeze distilled water, again, I've had a better result than this. So, but yeah, it looks really cool. So now I'm gonna switch to the final result and the freezing.
So yeah, this is the final freeze here. Kind of slow at the beginning. I'm speeding this up as pretty much fast as it'll speed up. This is super speed, and right there you can see it drags out those lines. It pulls and extrudes those lines as the sphere. I guess it's like oblate spheroid or whatever, but as it goes into the center, and eventually it cuts it off, it lops them off, it stops doing it. Then some creepy shit happens. When I think it's totally frozen, you see some patterning, like some frost kind of appear and disappear on it. And at lower speeds, it looks like there's a reflection of someone passing off to the right outside of camera. it's really creepy. But if you're doing it sped up here, you can just see it's frost. And we'll look at it one more time here. The initial freeze, it frosts at the top. And then the surface freezes and it freezes from the bottom. And then right at the bottom, it starts to pull up those threads. And then it cuts it off right about there, I think. Because it doesn't pull those threads all the way to the center. And I think it was like kind of a sphere inside of a sphere there for a while. And then it freezes up. So that's cool. So I actually do have footage, I haven't found it yet. I have it somewhere, of the last time I did this. So I'm going to throw in a little bit of bonus freezes in here so you can see what it looked like when I recorded it back in 2013.
Got an artsy fartsy shot here for you.
Thanks everybody for watching, and I'll see you next time.
Cool party.